cancel two of them in the big square. So it's a third of the volume of the smallest box that it would fit into. And as I said, people in ancient times knew that the volume was a third of the volume of the corresponding box. And so this is an example of using calculus effectively to work a volume using the concept of parallel cross-section. The parallel cross-sections are the squares in the case of this problem that you could draw at varying distances between the base and the peak. Now, doing the integral like this, which is how we would do our homework, actually shortcuts or abbreviates setting up an upper sum and a lower sum as I've done with the long sheet paper. So you can refer to the various pictures that I have in reviewing how you really do get this same answer using upper sums and lower sums. Here's our candy lady.
Good morning. I'm sorry to interrupt. We're missing quite a few students, I think. But we'll see. I just want to check on the Micron students and make sure everybody's here. Dan is here. Yeah, I know. Milton is here. Richard? Perfect. Penny's here. Ian. Oh, perfect. Mark. Checking, maybe bring some more, but welcome to Micron. Welcome back to school. It was a short break, 3 weeks is not very long, and here we are again. So it is important that everyone know, even if you are a Micron employee and you're just coming for class, do not park in the visitor parking lot. They send me an email and tell me to get them to move their car, and if you're a Micron employee, I think they probably copy your supervisor, so don't park in the visitor parking lot. It's a big deal to them. For visitors, be sure and not open any doors except those front doors. If you go out other exit doors, the security alarms will go off. For other security things, if there is any kind of an emergency, follow the Micron students or let them take the lead. Looks like you got another student.
Okay, I'm on the side of the paper, page 1 and 2. There's T in the red pen. So, you can look down at the three pictures that are on the left. And you notice I have tried anyway to draw the pyramid and then draw boxes that are entirely inside the pyramid. So that the sum of volumes of these boxes, you see the top one, there are two boxes. The top one of the boxes has volume zero because to stay entirely inside the pyramid, as you come to the peak, you have to shrink the box that you're trying to put from here up to here down to zero because it comes to the peak. So that box actually has volume zero. The only box, if you're doing a lower sum with two boxes that you really have, would be the one where the top would be this section and it would come down into here. I didn't draw this on the board, but you have it on the paper. The second one down on the left, where I'm doing four boxes for lower sum, again, with the lower sum, since the pyramid comes to a point, the box that's entirely inside and goes clear to the top has to shrink down to just a vertical line, so it has zero volume. The next one down would be the one for which there'd be the the top, that would be a section like this, and then you come down vertically from the four corners. And so there are three boxes there with a non-zero box. And then for eight, what I'm doing, you see, is doubling the number of boxes. So for eight, then there are seven of the boxes for which there is a positive volume. And again, the very topmost one has volume zero because you stay entirely inside the slanting figure. You have to squeeze the top one down to the line. So then, for instance, go back to the center of the page. I'm using the letter L for lower sum and the letter U for upper sum. The upper sum boxes are on the right, where the portion of the pyramid is entirely inside the box. So the upper sum boxes are all too big, and the lower sum boxes are all too small. And this is the same kind of game that you should remember seeing in Math 170 or whatever first semester calculus you took, wherever you took it, where you were talking about areas of curves and using rectangles, and you had rectangles where the top was entirely below the curve and the rectangle went down to the x-axis, and you had rectangles where the curve was entirely below the top of the box, and then you have an upper sum and a lower sum, and in the limit, if there is an area, that common limit of the upper sum and lower sum would match the value of the integral. This is the same game. All the applications in chapter 6 are this upper sum, lower sum game. And I won't play the game with drawings like this every time, but that's what you're shortcutting when you do the integral the way that you expect to do it, like this, with the antiderivative. You'll see that the formula, 1/3 a squared h, that we got, is what both the lower sum and upper sum, using the boxes, will get the common limit. So, for instance, if you were in the center of the page here and looking at the lower sum, you're going to have a box, the largest of the boxes down at the base. That then would be the 3/4 A for the height, and where A, remember, is the dimension of the square base. So you have 3/4 A, and you see your height then, well, your 3/4 A then is the base of the largest box. Remember that what we're getting here is that the base is the A over H, H minus Y, and then the base squared, as we have it here, would be this area, and then you're multiplying that by your height. So you have the height as the factor at the right. I'm looking at the left-hand column, the middle two, the L4 and the U4 pictures and calculations, and the H/4 then is the height for each of the four boxes, and I have that as a factor out at the right, and then the 3a/4 square is the area of the square base of the bottom box, the A over two, which is 2A over four. When I wrote it here, I wrote it 2A over four squared. That would be the area of the base of the second box up. The A over four squared would be the area of the base of the third box up from the bottom. And then the 0A over four would be the area of the base of the top one, which really isn't there. So my lower sum then can be written this way in terms of the base of the square base pyramid and the height of the square base pyramid. Notice if you work this out, you have 9 and 4 are 13, and 1 are 14. You have common factor a square of h. And then here you have 4 square, and then another 4. So you have 14 over 64, or 7/32. Notice that 7/32 is less than 1/3. You can use your calculator and compare the decimals. And I think, in fact, that I've done that on the other side of the paper. If you turn the page, I have the L4, and I have the 7/32 a square h, and I guess I never gave the decimal for 7/32, but I do have the decimals for 8 boxes and so on the opposite side of the page. So you can see that you have decimals less than a third, but as you take more and more slices, they're growing up toward 1/3. Then for the upper sum, where the boxes are outside the pyramid, I have again the common height, h over 4, and then the bottom one has the same base as the pyramid A, but I wrote it as 4A over 4 because I won't get back to use to take the limit. And then I have 3A over 4, 2A over 4, and then the top one in the upper sum has base A over 4. And so if you square these numbers, you have 16 and 9 are 25, and 4 are 29, and 1 are 30, a square h, and again, 4 square, and this 4. So 15/32, which is more than a third. And if you notice on the bottom of the side of the paper that says key, where I've gone for 8 boxes, I finally have at the very bottom of the page the decimal. So for the lower sum with 8 boxes, I have 0.2734 a square h, and the upper sum, I have 0.3984. So the one is more than a third, and the other is less. So we can take a limit and prove that if you let the number of slices increase up as n goes to infinity, that either way you get 1/3 a square h. So work with limits. You see, what you're dealing with is the sum of squares of the positive whole number. So what you need is a factoring formula. Factoring is, well, first of all, think of your algebra. Anything you write is an expression. Expressions that you hook together with pluses and minuses are terms. Factoring is rewriting terms as products or quotients. So factoring formula is taking the sum like this and rewriting it as a product. And it turns out that this is the factoring formula for the sum of squares. Now, you can see this, that's not proof, but you can see it for example, which we'll do in this one second. Probably about time for sign-up sheets. The first day, please, which is today, please answer all of my nosy questions, which is your name and what year in college approximately, what you're thinking of as a major. If you're from Idaho, I'm interested in what high school. If you're not from Idaho, what state, or from another country, what country. After today, I'll pass out the sign-up sheet every day. All you have to do is put your name on it. But I do keep attendance in doing that. And it's all spelled out in the CWI syllabus. It's on Blackboard, if you like stuff like that. It's spelled out on the back of this. So I really do expect to get anyway. Each paper here is just for your row, so just share it. Your row one, row two, and it goes down that row. As much as you can, I realize you can't do it perfectly, but as your dimension from this corner to that corner of your cross-sectional square that I'm kind of tracing the other two sides of would be, you know, the distance from this bottom curve to this top one, which is twice the square root of x. So the question is, what's the area of a square if S is the side of the square in terms of its diagonal, which is the D? Because the diagonal is what you know in terms of the distance X from this end to where the cross-sectional square is located. And we're taking these cross-sections from this end over to where X is 4. So the largest cross-section here at X equals 4, square root is 2, so it's 2 up and 2 down. So that's a square for which the diagonal is 2 plus 2. The smallest one is a square for which the diagonal is 0, an area that is 0. So what you do is law of the factors. This is a right triangle because it's a square. This is a 90 degree angle. So d square is s square plus s square. So 2 of them. So d is s root 2. And the area of the square when the side is s square. So that would be b over root 2 quantity squared. So b squared over 2. So whatever the x is, the diagonal here is twice square root x, and that square root 2 is your area. At any distance x from the left, the area of the parallel cross section is d square over 2 by geometry, where the d is twice square root x, that's square root over 2. So 4 over 2 is 2, square root squared is x. So the 2x here serves as our cross-sectional area in the same way that First, x square, and then a over h, h minus y of the quantity square here served as our cross-sectional area for the pyramid. And so our volume then is again the cross-sectional area integrated with respect to the thickness. That's our differential dx. Limits on x are 0 to 4. And the integral of 2x is 2x square over 2, so it's x square. We put in the limits, and that's what the book says it is. So once you understand what they mean to do, this is fairly easy to do. It's not very clear what they mean, I think. That's what I've been trying to tell you.
Yes. Is that the area of the triangle, or is that the whole area?
Well, I have, what I've used with my triangle is the law of Pythagoras to get this third side, but then the area of the square, you see, you have a square here, with the other two green sides is the square of the side. So right here, this becomes the area of the square. What I used with the triangle was not the area, but the law of Pythagoras to relate this to that.
So we have three more students that did not realize the class was here. They went to Nampa first.
Well,
that's understandable. I told them not to name that building Micron. They didn't listen to me.
Well, everybody in Micron knows you run this place, so they should listen. So fire them.
Yeah.
Well, just a minute. We'll give out some pages and we'll go on to the next part. So then my differential area would be the area of the circular slice here, which has radius 1 minus x square. So it's pi times radius square. And correspondingly, my differential volume, dv, would be this area times the thickness, which would be dx. So my volume would be the integral of that pi is out here, then I'd take 1 minus x squared and square it out. Notice that what I have here is what you call an even function. It's even because the exponents are either 0, 1 times x to the 0, or x squared, so 2 is even, or x fourth, 4 is even. That's where we get the name, the even function and odd function. So the polynomials where x has even exponents are even. When x has only odd exponents, it's odd. You should have heard something about even and odd in a college algebra class or pre-calculus, and that will sever. So I've written this out, the definition. More generally, f is even when f of minus x is f of x, and then the graph has y-axis symmetry, so cosine is even. And one of the things we'll learn in this class, toward the end of chapter 10, is how you write an infinite series for the cosine, and indeed that's powers of x that are only the even powers. And in the same way, the infinite series that represents sine x is powers of x that are only odd powers, and sine is odd. So anyway, when f is even, and you have an integral from minus to plus the same number, minus a to a, you can instead go 0 to a and put a 2 out front. Handy, because if you're evaluating the integral by hand, it's usually easy to work with zeros. So my volume then, which is this integral up here, is 2 pi times the same thing, 0 to 1. So now I do my antiderivatives, and I get x, 2x cubed over 3, and x cubed over 5, and you see how easy this is. Powers of 0 are all 0, and powers of 1 are all 1, so it's fractions. 1 minus 2 thirds plus a fifth, you do your common denominator, and that's what the book says, answer. Okay, number 10, again, this is the reason I gave you a copy of the book. If you look at the picture in the book, they show this with a blue background, I think, and then this is shown in kind of yellow. And you're told in this figure that the parallel cross sections are isosceles triangles. Isosceles, well, actually, isosceles right triangles. And that means these two sides are equal. ISO is the Greek for life or the same. Like in chemistry, isotopes have the same chemical properties and different weights and the chart and so on. In organic chemistry, isomers have the same mix of hydrogen and carbon but a different structure. And then the SCELES is a measure. You see, if you change this E to an A, you have our word scales. And what do you do when you scale something? You measure it. Right? You get on the scale, fat, 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 right? That's scaling, right? So isosceles means equal measure in that way. So then this side would be a leg, and this side would be a leg when you have a right triangle. And you see, your circle here is x squared plus y squared equal 1. That's this figure. And so you're measuring x this way or that way. So the leg down here, that's x at this point, and that's minus x, so the total distance is 2x. And so the area of the triangle, a half base times height, the base is 2x, and then the height is equal. And then what you want to do is write this dimension, the x, and then the 2x, in terms of the dimension this way, which is the y. And then you're going to integrate with y from this end to that end. So because of this, you see x squared is 1 minus y squared, so x is the square root. And then you have x and x, so two of them. And then this is equal. So a half base height gives you, the twos cancel here, but you still have that one, square root stays itself. So your differential volume then, in terms of the dimension y from here toward there, would be like this. And so you're going to integrate minus 1 to 1. Notice this is even. So again, you can go 0 to 1 and double. So there's 1, 2 here, but there are 2 of them now because of the even. And then I integrate this out and I get 8/3, which is what we say it is. Okay. So then look at what we call a solid of revolution, for which I have yet another handout.